Dear friends, on behalf of the family of Bill Hart, I want to thank you for joining us today. The family is hopeful that as restrictions are removed, there will be a greater celebration of Bill's life at some point in the future. But we wanted the opportunity for our immediate family to share today in this live stream and for us to worship God and to share sacred memories of Bill's life. And we hope through this that we will all find greater comfort and hope that will come to all of our hearts. You hear now these words of grace and greeting. When Christ died, he destroyed our death. And when Christ arose, he restores our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Bill Hart put on Christ, so in Christ may Bill Hart now be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves, even as Christ is pure. At the tomb of Lazarus, whom Jesus raised from the dead, he said these words, "I am the resurrection, and I am life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also." So we've come together today to praise God, to witness to our faith, and to celebrate the life of Bill Hart. May God grant us his grace, that in our pain we may find God's comfort, in sorrow, no hope, and in death, the power of resurrection. It's a wonderful obituary of Bill's life that was written, and I want to share that with you in these moments before our next song. Willie Frank Bill Hart, age 70, passed from this life into the next on Sunday, April 19th, 2020, in Fairhope, Alabama, surrounded by his three sons. Born on June 25th, 1949, to Jesse Hart Sr. and Verdinell Hurst Hart, Bill was a resident of Daphne, Alabama, and loved calling the eastern shore of Mobile his home. He was a graduate of Fairhope High School. Later, Bill served in the U.S. Army as an airborne ranger, first as an enlisted man and then as an officer, achieving the rank of captain. He commanded units in both the National Guard and the Army Reserve. And thanks to the GI Bill, he was first in his family to pursue a college education, earning his bachelor's degree from Mobile College, now the University of Mobile. He also served on the faculty of University of Mobile for many years. He earned his master's degree from the University of South Alabama, and among his many jobs, he was most proud of his work with the Muscular Dystrophy Association as a regional coordinator. His work also in admissions and institutional development and on the cabinet at the University of Mobile, and then starting his own business as a consultant. He was very active in the community and loved by his neighbors and many friends. He was an active member here at Spanish Fort United Methodist Church. Bill had a deep and abiding faith in God and a devotion to his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He had a great love of life and no fear of death. Bill loved sailboats, dolphins, pelicans, music. Parenthetically here, especially Jimmy Buffett music, playing guitar, long conversations, humor, cooking out, and spending time around the pool with friends, neighbors, and family. What Bill loved most were people, improving and enhancing the quality of their lives, and certainly moving them toward eternal life. That was his goal. And those who knew him best would say he achieved that goal. And for that, we are all eternally grateful. He is preceded in death by his parents, his brother Jesse Hart Jr., his sister Ramona Hart. He is survived by his two sisters, Jacqueline, Jackie Hart Harrison, and Wanda Hart Tucker of Pensacola. Three sons, Danny and Teresa, Rodney and Stacy. Jonathan and Liz, and 7 grandchildren, which were the apple of his eye, Will, Christopher, Leah, Noah, Catherine, Eden, Anna, many nieces and nephews and cousins. Bill will be most fondly remembered and greatly missed. We thank God for his life and the testimony and witness of his life and the sacred memories that will be shared today. Amen.
Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
God for hope and assurance and comfort. And one of the most beloved passages in all the Bible is the 23rd Psalm. Many of you know this psalm, and I invite you, if you're following along on our live stream, to join with me as we share this psalm together. Together, let us share this psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Would you please go to our great God in prayer with me? Almighty God, our Father, from whom we come and to whom our spirits return, you have been our dwelling place for all generations. You are our refuge and our strength. And when we lift our eyes into the hills, we know that our help comes from you. You are a very present help in our sorrow. And I ask now that you would indeed comfort the Hart family as they mourn the loss of a father, a pop, an uncle, a brother, a cousin, a friend, a mentor. Give us all your grace in the presence of death so that we might worship you. We cling to you as sure hope of our eternal life. And grant us peace and assurance that you prepared a place for Bill Hart, as you do for all of us who love you. We ask you now for your comfort, for our hearts, and to give us strength for this and our every time of need. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
A friend recently shared with me his thoughts on relationships and religion. Religion is a guy in church thinking about fishing. And relationship is a guy out fishing thinking about God. Matthew 4, 19 through 20, Jesus met a couple of guys on the beach fishing. He said, come follow me and I will send you out to fish for people. So they dropped his nets and they followed him. As dad's oldest, I was the guinea pig for his parenting skills. I like to think I made life easier for my brothers by breaking him in before Rodney was born. My youngest brother, he really had it easiest with dad, since Rodney and I spent a decade breaking down his defenses and discipline tactics before Jonathan joined us. But Jonathan also suffered his share of tough love from older brothers, still does. Bill Hart loved his military experience and service to his country. He valued his education. He loved faith, family, and fellowship. He was a father, a husband, brother, son, grandfather, a counselor, a spiritual mentor, a coach, and a friend to many. We all have our stories. I'm going to try to talk about what he was to me. Both of us having strong-willed personalities, sometimes he was an adversary. We faced off on more than one occasion, but the disagreements never invalidated the love between us. He was a counselor, giving me advice when I needed it, oftentimes unsolicited, but in times where I needed accountability for my actions, he called me out. He was my teacher. He introduced me to camping and canoeing. He taught me to swim, good study habits, people skills, life skills. Frankly, it's a bit awkward not having him here to proofread and edit this memorial before reading it to you now. He was my pep squad, always there to support me and cheer me on in anything that I did. not out of a sense of obligation, but out of a sincere desire to be part of my life experiences. He was a safety net, and not just for me. Dad was always there to catch someone that was about to fall. He shared his home, his personal belongings, his financial resources, his knowledge. Anything he had that would benefit someone in need, he would freely give of his time, money, efforts. He was a sentinel. It was, he saw himself, it was his job to keep watch, to protect his loved ones, his family, friends, neighbors. He was the guy in the watchtower. He was an expert. You all know this. He was the leading authority on everything, at least in his opinion. He did not hesitate to give legal advice, medical, financial, theological, auto mechanical, health, fitness, nutrition. Whether he had real knowledge of the topic or not, he had an air of confidence that was so convincing. I mean, Eskimos lined up at his door to pay good money for a box of ice. He was an extrovert. He loved social settings, professional and civic groups, chats over a cup of coffee. He loved coffee. Lunch dates, always insisting on picking up the check. He experienced real joy by being surrounded by people he loved. The more, the better. Dad was a big guy. He was clumsy. Watching him on a basketball court was sometimes like watching a young giraffe learn to walk. He's the only person I know that could roll a John boat like a kayak. I'll finish this up with something I shared on Facebook just a few hours after he passed. It was a photo of the two of us fishing. I think his center of gravity was both variable and volatile. It was always a good day fishing if he didn't fall out of the boat, but Dad was more of a fisher of men. He loved big. He left a rich legacy of relationships with so many good people. Dad had no fear of death. His relationship with our Creator was solid. His relationship with his friends and family was strong. He lived a life of love, and he will be truly missed.
I'm Rodney, his favorite son. I was the youngest son for a while, and Jonathan came along, changed that for me. I didn't prepare anything to say. I want to be open to God's Spirit leading me in what I say, and I'd like to honor Pop, that's what I call him, and honor God. Pop knew God, he knew Jesus, he knew that Jesus was the only way, and that Jesus is our only hope, and a magnificent hope. Losing Pop was the hardest thing that I've ever been through. But the days following that have been the closest that I've ever been to God, too. And I've experienced God's peace in a way that I never had before. And I'm thankful. We were going through Pop's stuff. I stayed in his house for a few days after he passed. And one of the things we found was one of his Bibles. And he has marked in it a passage that I want to read. And I'll try to read.
It's a familiar verse, 1 Corinthians 13, more often heard at weddings, but I think it's very appropriate now, and it's very appropriate to describe Pop. This is Paul writing through the inspiration of God's Holy Spirit. And now I will show you the most excellent way. If I speak in tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Doesn't that describe Pop very well, that section of scripture? Pop was a great big man physically, but he was a great big life. He touched so many people that I didn't realize until after he passed, and people had reached out to us and reached out through his phone and his Facebook. And we were, I think I speak for all of us, amazed at the impact that he had on so many people's life. And he did that because of how Christ impacted his life. He was a sinner. He knew that. All of us are. But he wasn't defined by that either. Pop lived with a freedom that comes from Jesus Christ. When you're in Christ, you are free from sin and death. Death has no power over you anymore if you have Christ. As soon as you pass from this life, a believer is immediately in the presence of God. And Pop was. We were at his side when he passed, and he passed peacefully. And he left this life exactly how he wanted to. And I think God blessed him with that. He talked about it ahead of time. Danny mentioned he wasn't afraid. He was ready, and he let us all know that he was ready. And that gives us comfort. And God has given us comfort through this. As hard as it's been, God has been that good and that faithful to me personally. And again, I've experienced him in a way that I've never experienced him before through this. And I've seen things happen that wouldn't have happened had this not happened, had Pop not passed away. There's already been fruit from it. Christ said that you'll know his believers by their fruit. Pop lived a life that was very fruitful. And I'm inspired to try to do the same. And I'm proud to be a son. I'm the jokester out of the three of us. And Pop enjoyed joking and cutting up and laughing. And we've done plenty of that, too. So this is a somber time. I understand that. But we've also enjoyed a lot of fellowship in the last few days. I'd like to take the liberty to speak for my brothers and my families, too, and thank everybody, too, that's reached out to us, that's prayed for us. So many people. We can't name them all, but we appreciate every one of them. A lot of people have fed us really well. Thank you for that. We love to eat. We appreciate every kind word, every gesture, and every prayer especially. We've also been praying. There's a lot of people that aren't represented up here today, neighbors who were Pop's family. Very sweet, very good, godly people. And Pop truly lived in community. And he truly loved his neighbors. Christ said the most important commandment is to love God, and the second one's like it, to love your neighbors. You can't do one without the other. And Pop understood that. And he lived that out in his life. And I want to do the same. In fact, Christ said that all of the law and the prophets was summed up in this way. Love God, love other people. There's a lot of things in the Bible we may not understand, but we can understand that. And I hope we'll focus on that. One other thing, these last few days have given me a different perspective, a better perspective, one that I appreciate because we live with so many distractions and we run around concerned about things that are not ultimately or eternally important. This has focused me completely on things that are important and that are precious, which are, and Pop understood this, relationships and people. And so I'm thankful that he passed that on to me in such a big way in his passing. Thank you.
I'm Jonathan Hart, Bill Hart's favorite son. I have the great privilege of serving as a pastor, and I've spoken at my share of services, but I knew that there would be two services that I would not speak at, my mother's and my father's. I didn't think I could. I didn't think I wanted to, and I was afraid of embarrassing myself, especially on live and then permanently archived video. But then I remembered the time my dad walked into the living room in nothing but his underwear because he had a hearing loss and he didn't hear my friend come in the front door or the fact that we were having a full-out conversation right there in the foyer. I also remembered every time he walked out onto the driveway to play basketball, decked out in his white V-neck undershirt, tucked into his green jersey shorts with bleach white crew socks and khaki-colored Chuck Taylor Converse All-Stars. He'd have a sweat towel draped around his neck and a one-gallon water cooler because he was very concerned about being dehydrated, even though any one of us could have walked into the kitchen 10 feet away for a drink. He'd walk out biting his bottom lip, hold up his two palms, clap his hands once, and yell, "Hit me!" Upon receiving the ball, he would launch into an incredibly effortful hook shot, preceded by the words, "Victim of the hook!" and followed by the ball slamming against either rim or backboard. So I'm not afraid to embarrass myself today, because Dad would do it for us. He would also not miss a chance to brag on his family, and so today we get to brag on him. Dad was the first person I ever told that I felt called to be a pastor, and he was the first person that affirmed and encouraged me in that pursuit. He told me I could do it. He told me I should do it if I was called, and he told me I'd be great at it. I overthink everything. And so I will miss his reassurance as we verbally process things together. When I was trying to decide where to go to seminary, I was paralyzed by the fear of choosing the wrong one against God's will for my life. Dad told me that he really didn't think God cared as much as I did, and that shocked me. But when I looked into his face, I realized he was speaking on the authority of a father. He was so proud, he just wanted me to be a pastor. The details were negotiable. But, he said, if you're really that concerned, Know that if you get halfway to the wrong seminary, God is perfectly capable of sending a giant fish to swallow you and spit you out at the right one. I laughed out loud. It was practical, it was down to earth, yet biblically and theologically sound advice, and it has guided me ever since. Years later, when I graduated from seminary, we had a party in Kentucky, and there was a family that adopted us while we lived there, and I was so excited for Stuart and Carla, our adopted parents, to meet my biological parents. And upon meeting my dad, Carla was all smiles, and after she met him, she told me my dad was winsome. I knew immediately as she shared the word that this was the word for which I had been searching for 27 years. My dad was winsome. Bill Hart was winsome. He was charismatic, outgoing, and magnetically attracted people to himself. I wonder what words or phrases come to your mind today as you remember our dad. What stories and memories as you think of Bill Hart? My brothers and I have an invitation. We would like to invite you to share in the comments of this video the words, phrases, stories, and memories that come to your mind when you think of this man. One positive thing about these unusual circumstances is that we have the platform to share that. And so we would love for you to share that with us so that we can hang on to them and read them as we remember this man together. There are so many things that I thought were just normal about my dad until I would tell someone and other people would react. Like when I told a friend just recently how he installed gates in his privacy fence for two different sets of neighbors to be able to come into his backyard and use his swimming pool without knocking first or going through the house. I realize when I stop and think about it that I've never heard of anyone else doing that, like ever. I also remember how he used permanent traffic paint to put a four-square box in his driveway for the kids in the cul-de-sac and to even host neighborhood four-square tournaments. Who does that? Dad did. Because he realized life is not about transactions, it's about relationships. People are the greatest legacy we can hope to leave, and Dad left a great legacy. Two Fridays ago, Bill Hart went for a walk. When he got to the very end, in the median right outside his house, in view of his loving neighbors, he experienced cardiac arrest and collapsed. For those who were there, I know it was traumatic. I can't even imagine. But I want you to know today that my brothers and I consider you heroes and angels. And there is nowhere that I can think of any other way or any other location I think of that Dad would have wanted his mortal life to end. So thank you to our heroes and our angels who loved our dad so well. I'm thinking especially of you, Chris and Tanya Tregg. What a metaphor. Dad went for a walk. Incidentally, one of my wife's favorite memories of Dad was just in the last couple of years when she called him out of the blue and asked if he wanted to meet her at the Fairhope Pier just to walk with her, which of course he did. So Liz and Dad walked for like an hour just talking about life. Pop probably pontificated with her the great mysteries, gave her empathy and coaching on her dilemmas, made her feel much more at ease, and best of all, made her feel loved and supported. She told me yesterday that she felt like he had the spirit of adoption. He could make people who weren't family feel like family. While Danny and Rodney and I were standing around his hospital bed saying goodbye, Rodney smiled, looked up, and said, "I have finished the race." That's pretty cool. He was referring to the fact that Pop had just gone for a walk, and he was quoting 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 through 8, which I want to read out of one of Dad's Bibles. It's amazing. It just hit me today that Dad had three Bibles, and so each of us got one, and I will always treasure this. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." Not only is this exactly how Pop died, it's how he lived. He was finishing strong every day for years. He lived each day as if it could be his last. And as we've said multiple times already, he had no fear in death. On the way to the hospital, we were reminiscing about the strength that all of us and many others drew from him. And my brother Rodney laughed and said, "You know, it's amazing because he was wrong like 90% of the time. but he was confident 100% of the time. And that's what was so reassuring about our dad. In an unsafe world, when you knew you were unsafe, he could tell you you're safe, and you believed him. The world feels less safe to me now. I'm going to have to get used to that. And I'm going to have to let him cheer me on from bleachers that are located in a different section of the stadium as he continues to tell us that we're safe and that we're okay. But today I tell you this, I may be wrong about 90% of the things that I think I know, but I am 100% confident that our dad, Pop, Bill Hart, is with the Lord. One word that comes to my mind is ragamuffin. And if you don't know that word, I would encourage you to read what I think was Pop's favorite book, The Ragamuffin Gospel by Brennan Manning. Dad knew he didn't deserve God's grace or heaven, but he trusted in Jesus Christ alone to get him there. He told me more than once that if trusting Jesus wasn't enough to get him in, then he wasn't getting in. And to that, I believe 100% God says, bingo. So, Pop, I'll say what I said every time we parted ways in the last years of our relationship, whether on this side of the veil or the other. I love you, and I'll see you soon.
Well, just to testify to Bill's infiltration of every aspect of society, I met with him one-on-one for a while, and he mentored me, too. I used to meet him at his little office. The first time that I met him, all I thought was, that guy's up to something. Like, what? He's up to something, and it might not be good. I don't know. He always had that look on his face, and so I was like, I got to find out more about this guy. And so he was kind enough to even mentor musicians. We'll sing one of his favorite songs.
I will.
Gospel lesson we share is out of John 14, familiar words, words of hope and assurance and comfort that Jesus left for his disciples. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place I'm going. I will not leave you orphaned. I'm coming again to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I've said these things to you while I am still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you all of what I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let them be afraid." The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. I want to share some personal thoughts with you today and offer words of hope and assurance as we continue in the celebration and memory of Bill Hart's life today. As I thought more personally about Bill, I would classify him kind of as a man among men. That's the phrase that came to me. It's been noted here today that Bill was a little taller in stature. In many cases, he might be head and shoulders over most men. But his physical stature was only the outer working of something that ran much deeper. It's always the inner spirit and character of the person that makes them so significant and so special. I knew that Bill served in the Army and Special Forces as an airborne ranger, even achieving the rank of captain. And when I hear the words airborne ranger, it automatically makes me think of someone with great courage, of someone who has a deeper level of commitment than perhaps most men do. There's no question that Bill was a patriot, that he had great love for his country. And I know there are probably many untold stories about his service to our nation. And for that, we are most grateful today. When you met Bill, there's almost an automatic connection with him. He was someone also who was very self-aware. He knew who he was. And more importantly, he knew whose he was. And I think that certainly came because he had a deep and abiding relationship with his Creator, the one who made him. and the one that made the creation that he was also in tune with. He was a person that I like to say cooperated well with the grace of God working in his life. Many of us struggle and resist the operation of God's grace in our life. But I think Bill was in tune with that in great ways. And I think that gave him a greater freedom to love without fear, to love on a deeper level perhaps than most. And I believe that is where he really stood head and shoulders above most of us. I had the honor of helping lead the celebration of life for Bill's mother, Verdinelle. And I learned some very significant things as I shared in that service. But certainly one of the most important ones was the values and faith in Bill's life was instilled in him by his family. His mother was one who sang gospel songs, sang almost everywhere they went, played the guitar. And I learned that Bill actually learned to play the guitar and sing from his mother, especially gospel songs. And one of the pictures I had in my mind, again being at her service and now with this service, is the great reunion that's taking place even now with them. And I can picture them singing with all the saints in glory, singing a song the angels cannot sing, "I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb." It's a promise that God has for all of us that Jesus talked about in the gospel. For all those who die in Christ, as Bill has, will be joined with our Lord and with our loved ones, participating in that great and glorious reunion day, singing the songs of glory. Bill is enjoying that now. Thanks be to God. It's reminded also this scripture I read at Bill's mother's service that I thought appropriate today. It's Revelation 14:13. "And I heard a voice from heaven saying, write, blessed are those who die in the Lord from now on, yes, says the Spirit, so that they may rest from their labors and their deeds follow them." Well, today we deeply grieve Bill's loss, and particularly the suddenness of his loss, his family, as within our church family and with our community. But we're reminded today also that we grieve as people in hope because we know that Bill died in the Lord. His faith was genuine and it carried over into the authentic deeds of his life, places of his work as in the University of Mobile, places as in service to our country, places in service through community organizations like MDA. We saw it in his work as a consultant. We saw it in and through his work and mission through the church. We saw it in the early morning men's group here that we call Fight Club. But more than anything else in any other place, and most importantly, the deeds and legacy that Bill leaves behind is most greatly seen by what we witnessed here today. Through his sons, through his grandchildren, who knew their pop, loved them unconditionally, as God loves us. And it is a love that indeed the scripture says, from which we can never be separated. In our minds today, we know and believe certainly and think that Bill perhaps left us all too soon. It is difficult to face separation, especially in a sudden loss as his. One of our ritual prayers says that we shrink before the mystery of death. And further thought about this, I recognize once again the sobering reality of the uncertainty of our lives. We do not choose when we enter this world, our birth, and we do not choose when we leave. Life in many ways remains a mystery to us. We would all wanted Bill to have had many more years here. But I believe that Bill would want to go in such a manner that he did as well, as been affirmed here today, even by his sons. He would not want to linger and struggle for others to care for him. In reality, Bill has made the best preparation anyone could. He knew Christ. He was following Christ as his Savior and Lord. And he knew that in Christ, That was the very hope of glory. Said at the very outset of this service, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and life. Our Lord and our Christ has died. He is risen. He's coming again. And where Christ is, Bill will be also. We sang the old Rugged Cross just a moment ago. There was a copy of that hymn that was in Bill's Bible. It's a special version that he no doubt played many times and sang and played many times. So that's why, one of the reasons why we included today in the service. One of the great truths of that song are the words, I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. Bill cherished the old rugged cross. And in his life, he has laid down his earthly trophies. And the other line says, I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Bill has exchanged the cross now and received a crown. What greater thought that could we have today than to know that spiritual reality? By eyes of faith, we see this. In the earlier passage that Jonathan shared in 2 Timothy 4:7, talks about a crown and exchanging the cross for the crown. So Bill has indeed fought a good fight. Bill has indeed finished the race, and he has kept the faith. And we know and are assured that there is a crown of righteousness that awaits him and everyone as he who is in Christ and who longs for the appearing of Jesus. Thanks be to God, the glorious victory that is ours in Christ. Thanks be to God for the wonderful legacy of Bill Hart and the testimony of his life. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the witness and life of Bill Hart. Thank you for the assurance that his life in you will never end. Give us courage to face the future unafraid and to know that nothing in life or death can separate us from your great love. Give us eyes of faith to see that Bill is resting from his labors here, but his deeds of love and many sacred memories follow him. Hold us in this life closer to one another, that we may serve and love each other as Christ through Bill has loved us. Help us to live a life in faithfulness to Christ, that we too may join with Bill in the place that you have made as our eternal home. We pray in the name of Jesus, the one who has taught all of us to pray together. Will you pray the Lord's Prayer with me? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Once again, on behalf of Bill's family, we thank you for joining us today. May the peace and grace of Jesus be with you, and the very hope of heaven fill all our hearts. Amen.